Cole with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. I'm here in Las Vegas, Nevada, on location at Hasena Farms, which is basically a farm that a husband and wife started literally just out of their house without having to buy farmland. And I'm going to let you guys know that you can't start a farm whether you have a house with some space or even if you just have an apartment. I've visited farms, microgreens farms, where they grow food inside a bedroom, right? So I want to encourage you guys, right, to create your own job if that's what you want to do, right? And stop working for the man if you don't want to do that anymore. You know, the family here, the wife has a job and she helps out with the farming when she's off work. And then the husband basically just does the farm full time and he takes some side jobs here and there to keep the farm going. They work quite hard because this is Las Vegas. It's one of the most difficult places in the country to grow your own food, but they are making it happen here. They got a small patch in the front where they got some vegetables and flowers growing, and then also in the backyard, that's where the main growing that they have happening. So I'm gonna go ahead and give you guys a tour of what they're growing here and how they're growing successfully in Las Vegas. So the first thing I wanna tell you guys is that they probably started gardening in 2012, so about 10 years now they've been gardening. And they started gardening because they wanted to have higher quality food. The wife is Japanese and they really have a good food culture in Japan, and the husband is American, grew up in the Midwest, maybe not eating the healthiest stuff, a lot of canned foods, and just didn't really know the difference that good quality food can make and how much more enjoyable it can be. So they started growing a garden to have higher quality food, and then they got pretty proficient at gardening, and about 5 years ago they decided to basically turn their property into a farm. And just 2 years ago, a couple years ago, they started selling at the farmer's market, and that's when I met them. And I'm like, hey, I want to check out your farm. And over a year later, I'm finally here checking it out and being able to share with you guys and showing you guys what they do. You know, also when I come out to places, I learn a lot of things. I also get to teach them a lot of things, and so we could kind of like, you know, make each other better. And also I get to share a lot of things with you guys out there that are watching, some tips and tricks to have a successful farm. Or more importantly, if you guys live in the Las Vegas area, you're gonna learn some techniques that they've learned here so that you guys can be successful growing food here in the Mojave Desert. So anyways, let's go on and go for the tour. All right, so I thought I'd give you guys a hand cam tour. First up, they got a nice existing mulberry tree that they're getting back into health and getting it to be harvestable. In the front yard, they basically just have it set up. They're growing in the ground and they've amended the soil with compost, different kinds of compost and different soil amendments. They're growing a lot of like bunching onions. They grow quite well and they have a good market for them. In addition, besides growing just the vegetables, they do cut flowers. And to be honest with you guys, like cut flowers sell for more money. People pay more money for like a whole bouquet of fresh cut local flowers than they would for some vegetables. So, you know, honestly, to make good money, I would say grow more flowers that look pretty that people will buy. Next, they got some daikon radish they're trying to grow in the summertime. It's like purple daikon, so I like those a lot. They just they start all their plants from seed themselves. These are direct seeded. A lot of them they may do from transplants. I'm not sure you guys are just using a standard drip tape, but they're using a unique system on the end here. They basically just have two pieces of wood sandwiched together and they bend over the ends of the drip tape, and then they just use these clamps. They're like a dollar and they just have some eye bolts like stuck into the ground to hold these clamps in place. So like I kind of like this technique because they could just basically pull this up and then they can remove the drip tape from the entire bed by just you know, removing this, and their drip tape is at the preset spacing. As well, the main thing they got to watch out for is as long as their wood don't rot, they're in good shape. The other thing they're growing, actually it's interesting to me to see because I've never seen this happen before, is that they're growing edamame beans for the edible pods. And they said they grow quite well. This is their second year growing the edamame. And they basically just have it spaced out. I think it's like maybe 1 foot per. All right, over on this side, they got some edible amaranth and some more flowers. And then they got some eggplant growing there, and they got some okra. So okra is another crop that really does good here. Also the eggplant, another really good one to grow. They're really easy plants. I want to show you guys this. This is a
good thing to tell you guys about. Over on here, they have a bed of sunflowers, which actually sell quite well and grow quite well as well. But over here, they have a whole line of okra. So you can see the okra on the right side and the okra on the left side. And I believe they were planted around the same time. But why is one so small and one so big? Because it's a soil. So if you guys get the wrong soil, right, your plants are going to be stunted and things are not going to grow as well. The soil over on this side is the soil from Terra Firma, which is a local compost company. They make their own compost. And the plants just did not grow well with the Terra Firma soil. But the soil over here is a soil I recommend. It's the Viragrow soil from Viragrow. Link down below to the video, if I remember, for where you can get the best soil in Vegas. And this stuff is growing a lot better with the Viragrow soil. All right, up by the front, they have a nice Meyer lemon tree that they're going to get going. And then over in this area, they have lots of crabgrass. But to hopefully overcompete with the crabgrass, they planted mint, which should really crowd out the crabgrass. But my estimation is that the mint's going to take over, and then the crabgrass is going to come up in between it. So the crabgrass is going to be harder to pull out. So my solution, if you have crabgrass anywhere, is I would totally just eradicate the crabgrass before planting anything, because if there's even a little crabgrass left, you're going to be battling it, and it's not going to be fun. Let's see, spinning around here, they're growing some squash, edible squash. I just saw a squash bug a little bit earlier. They grow some basil as well, actually. The basil over here, they're using for cut flowers. Actually, it's quite pretty because it's like purple basil for cut flowers. I would personally eat it. But then the basil over here is green basil, and they're using that for edible basil, but it's actually already flowering. And then they also have some bitter melon growing up the trellis along here that's doing pretty good. And they have more basil, and then just a more recent planting of the eggplants back over here, and some more okra.
All right, now we're gonna head into the backyard, and this is basically their alleyway that you can see. They have a stockpile of soil, so they have a stockpile of the Viragrow soil that they're basically almost out of now. And then also they have their own composting bins where they compost all their waste. They also get some local mushroom compost from a local mushroom farm, and will add this to their compost tumblers when they're composting. It really helps to heat up the compost. You can see they have a compost thermometer there, as well as just a standard compost pile. So they have different methods of composting. They just have the pallet rack there. And then they actually like these lifetime composters. I haven't seen this format before. It's like the larger square ones that they've held up pretty good for them, although a few pieces have rusted out. They made their own compost sifter trommel thing, and actually they found this motor actually at the Goodwill, and it was actually for a grain mill, I guess, and it has this gear reduction on there. So this is a nice little setup. I really need something like this. It's basically using like bike tires with this screen with a couple rollers. Like, this is just made from scratch. It's totally ingenious. I love this thing. And of course they got, a chipper if they need a chipper. And check this out, guys. See that frame? That frame is for a Juraform composter that rusted out. So I'm like, wow, that's not right. They should replace the panels for you. Anyways, they use it now to hold the drip tape to roll it out when they're rolling out a new drip tape bed. And then you can see they got some chickens in the back, and they basically just have all row crops here, including sunflowers, more of the edamame. They're growing the shiso underneath the cover, which is interesting because the shiso just comes up as a weed in my garden, but they're growing the green and the purple, and I'm growing the Breton. And I think this is maybe some baby okra. And they got some really nice looking kale, actually. It's really nice looking kale for the summertime. Oh, they got the red kale in the back row. And they got lots of squashes that are growing over here as well. And then a whole bunch of nice sized eggplants. I think this is the side of their garden with like the better soil that they've been growing a while. And then they grew some red carrots that they're letting grow
to seed, to save the seeds. And then they have a lot more edamame that they're growing. And these rows, I think, are like 50 feet long. So these are like a lot of plants to deal with. They have different methods, like sometimes they'll like direct seed and sometimes they will put in from transplants because they flip like beds like several times. Was it three or four times a year they'll flip one bed. So they're really doing lots of planting like regularly. And then they got more squashes over here, chickens over there, and then this is like more area they planted. This is looking pretty nice. They got all these long rows, and they do 18 inches on center, I believe, of the peppers. They got different kinds of unique peppers. And I really like how they're like putting in the stakes. They're kind of putting in the stakes at an angle. It seems to work better for them. So actually, that's a new technique I might have to use. And they got some, they got the fish peppers, and it's bordered with onions. So actually, I kind of like that. I like that setup. Although if it was me, well, I guess it's still young, I'd probably try to fit something in between the pepper plants because there's like too much space exposed. I would want to try to cover the ground a little bit better. And over here, they got a lot more of the bunching onions. They got special like Japanese varieties of like the bunching onion things. They like that a lot. And they're solarizing this bed. And then here's more eggplants. They just got planted there. Nice long rows, lots of eggplants, and then like long row of sunflowers as well.
All right, so I wanted to share a few insights with you guys after walking their whole farm and seeing everything that's growing. Number one, if you'll notice that they're only growing certain crops. Like you're thinking, John, where are the tomatoes, man? Everybody grows tomatoes. Well, tomatoes aren't necessarily an easy crop here to grow in Las Vegas. Maybe they have a few experiments with a few random tomato plants growing, but to me, they just don't grow well. They're growing a lot more peppers because peppers do a lot better. And you know, if you're farming for money, right, and you have a tomato crop failure, you don't get anything, then it's costing you money because you're using space. So instead, they're investing their space and using it wisely to grow peppers that are going to grow a lot better than tomatoes, as well as eggplants. They have an enormous amount of the Japanese eggplants, which I love, which I'm growing, I think, over 60 plants myself, but they have a lot more than that. Of course, I don't sell my produce that I grow. I eat it or preserve it, but they're growing it for sale. Also, they're growing the okra. Okra is another amazing crop that does well in the summer. They're growing lots of actually the onions, just the regular onions, the green onions, bunching onions. They're growing a lot of those because I guess they grow well and they sell well for them also. If it was me, I'd grow more basil because basil is like the number one crop that I grow in the desert and it just does so well. Basil costs a lot of money to buy and it's quite sad that if you go buy basil in the store that's already been pre-cut, it's looking really terrible because it doesn't ship or travel well. A new one to me is the edamame. I had no clue that the edamame beans did so well. Of course, they're growing an organic variety. And you know, you eat them fresh and they take maybe like 60 days, they're saying. Normally it's a bit longer, but in the desert, the edamame loves this climate and the soil here and has been doing quite well for them. So that's a new one that I'm learning. Maybe I'll try to grow some edamame, some soybeans. And in addition, of course, their kales are doing quite well. Like, I mean, I usually grow kale over the winter time because it bolts in the summer. But this year I put in a summer planting that I planted once it heated up. And I'm actually growing dinosaur kale, and I'm glad to see that actually got a nice looking curly kale as well as some like red boar style kale as well that are doing well for them. So if you really, oh, and then the other thing they're doing a lot of the edible flowers, and they put in a lot of zucchini for the squash as well as for the flower buds that they'll sell to a local chef. So, you know, they don't have like a great diversity of things, but they're really focusing on what they could do well. And I think this is quite a really good thing to do for you guys that are home gardeners or for farms. I mean, likewise, you know, I plant one bed of tomatoes every year because I know I want some tomatoes. But once it heats up, they don't do that well and they get a lot of bug damage. I'm having some spider mite issues myself with the tomatoes, but the spider mites don't mess with my peppers, for example, which I grow a lot more of.
I also grow a lot of basil because it's super simple, super easy. And I have basically two beds of the onions these days, like they're growing. Maybe I'll expand out, but I don't eat that many onions. And two beds does me fine. Of course, I also I'm growing okra, so I have over 30 plants of okra this year, maybe 36 plants. They're doing quite well for me as well. But also, more importantly, I grow a few other things like that I'd recommend they look into here, such as water spinach and Malabar spinach. Also the Belay tree, that's a good, like, I guess you could start those from seeds. Ahubiscus, manuhot, they could grow that from seed for the season, because they won't last the year. It gets too cold in the summertime. But those are another nice leaf that you could grow in the summer that grows relatively quickly for me so far. Other thing I'd probably recommend to grow is maybe some kind of like go-to cola. I think that would be good in some of the shady spots, maybe underneath the eaves of the house, because that's also a very easy to grow plant, or the pennywort plant also. Anyways, I got a few more areas of farm I want to show you guys before it gets too dark. All right, so they put up a little greenhouse so that they could start their seedlings in. I guess they have this up year round, but this time of year it's getting kind of hot, so they got basically the shade cloth over it, but it's still getting quite hot in there, and they actually have a fan running. If they want to take it to the next level, maybe they want to get a swamp cooler to kind of keep it cool in there, because some of the stuff's drying up. But to me, the most impressive thing that they do here is that they start everything from seed. They don't like buy any transplants. On occasion, maybe they'll get some plugs or some cuttings or something like that. But to me, that's super impressive, because the majority of my garden is all from transplants that I buy at the nursery. They do things the hard way here, which I would not even try to do because I'd probably fail. But they have all these plant starts that they start from seed themselves, usually sometimes inside in their microgreens, set up underneath lights, and then they bring them out here to grow bigger in the greenhouse or even just right outside the greenhouse. So I'm going to go ahead and do a hand cam and show you guys what they got. All right, they are going all in on their edamame. So they have lots of edamame plants right here that they'll be transplanting in. And here's the more onions they got. Some of them are drying out a little bit, more edamame. Let's kind of go inside their greenhouse and see what they need to be planting out. They still have some peppers and eggplants in here. They use the soil blocking kits here. Looks like some basil there. They got lots of sage. They're probably gonna put the sage in a certain area. More peppers. And let's see, I'm not sure, do they like garden gnomes here or not when the dinosaurs eaten the garden gnomes? Over on this side, they have a lot more different, kind of mostly herbs, it looks like to me, growing in basil that they need to get in the ground, maybe some peppers too. And that's pretty much it for their little greenhouse. All right, now I want to take you guys into their little garage. This little garage is like converted over to their like workspace. So they got a lot of cool stuff happening in here, a lot of cool things to show you. They like totally have a big whiteboard where they plan out all the stuff. They, you know, do some work on the bench here. Looks like they're doing some work on some irrigation stuff lately. And they got different kinds of amendments over here that they use. They have like lots of amendments, man. This is like one legit farm. This farm has like more amendments than I've seen at most farms I visit. So, you know, I know that the quality of the food they're growing here is definitely top rate. They got like all the cool stuff that I wish I would buy, because I'm too cheap to buy all the crazy stuff. I just get a few main things. I mean, they got my favorites, of course, things like the rock dust and different kind of green sand and nutrient fertilizers and the C90 minerals. And they got organic alfalfa, kelp, gypsum, guano, green sand, feather meal, and they got bags over here of the perlite and alfalfa, the soil humate, which is something I like, I haven't talked too much about, but you get that at the IFA store, $16 a bag. It's one of the best investments you could make. It basically adds carbon and trace minerals into your garden. And I'll show you guys the cheap trick for getting alfalfa meal cheaper than you can buy it. All right, we all love saving a buck, and I learned a new technique to save a buck. And what the farmer does here is he buys this organic alfalfa by
Stan Lee. I think this is at the Cow Ranch Farm Store. And this is actually made for, this is pelletized alfalfa. And he found that it's a lot cheaper to buy it like this instead of alfalfa meal, you know, as a fertilizer. So what he does, he has this cheap Black & Decker blender. So he basically takes this blender off and he basically will put in these pellets. Hey, I used to feed my rabbit pellets like this. He put the pellets inside in the blender and then basically blend it up and turn it into the powder that then he'll sift out and then he'll store in this big bin. So now he has alfalfa meal that is more easily added to his soil as an amendment, you know, because you wouldn't want to add whole pellets to your soil. Although if it was me, I might just like skip all the steps of grinding it and adding it to the soil. Maybe I'd grind this stuff or just put the pellets in whole into my compost as is to let it break down and then put it in my soil. So there's a few ways to do it, but I like that he actually, you know, grinds up his own alfalfa to have alfalfa meal that's more readily available for his plants. One of the coolest things at the farm, in my personal opinion, is the walk-in cooler. You guys don't understand, I have three fridges in my house and I don't even have a farm, but I need a walk-in cooler so I can easily store all the produce that I'm eating and buying. And he got a really good deal on this, found it used, and it basically put a cool bot in there and an air conditioning unit, and has a nice walk-in cooler inside that he stores all his produce before it goes to market. And he's got a lot of eggplants in there, some kale and whatnot in there. Totally amazing. I think I want to show you guys one more part of the farm. It's actually indoors where they start their microgreens and seedlings. All right, so now I'm inside in the springtime. These racks are totally loaded. There's a bunch of racks here and they start a lot of the plant starts down here. So they have like the soil blocks. This is like lavender they're growing. I think they got a lot of beets growing as well. And then they also do the sprouts, or some people would call these microgreens. So they like to do the pea sprouts. Sell these at market. Sometimes I let them grow like nice and tall. So they're good for like stir fry, but if you want to eat them, they're better when you just eat them raw in salads and you want to get them when they're a little bit smaller. Now the cool thing is, if you guys are looking for some microgreen seed trays and you're local here, right? He'll sell them to you. He's got a lot of these on hand, and actually these are quite durable plastic compared to the normal ones you'd get. And these are top trays that have holes, and the bottom trays are just solid. So he'll set you a set of these, one of each, both of them, for $5. So that's a good deal for some nice reusable trays if you guys are looking for some trays to grow microgreens. He got a few too many than he needs. So he's trying to clear them out and get into people that wants to grow some microgreens. All right, so now I have the pleasure of interviewing Keith, the urban farmer, market gardener, whatever you want to call him, here in his backyard on his farm. And we got a few questions for him today. So the first question is, Keith, why did you decide to start a farm in Las Vegas, one of the most difficult places to grow in the country?
Yes, that's a good question. I don't know. We started gardening, and one thing led to another, and just got out of control. And we fell in love with it, and I said, hey, you know, I'd like to do a little bit more of this. And one thing led to another, and I started putting beds in the ground. So, and here we are.
All right, so it sounded like to me like your hobby kind of became like a passion, and you wanted to try to like maybe make some money at your hobby and maybe get out of your old kind of work?
Yeah, maybe? Yeah, it was a lot more fulfilling. The more I did it, the more I got excited about it, and the more I got excited about it, the more other people got excited about it, and I enjoyed doing it, and it's hard to say exactly how it started, but it just
everything happens. Yeah, so I think the other thing that's really important to me to get out to the world is that I really want to encourage you guys to support local farmers and eat local food, and more importantly, seasonal food, right? If you guys go to the grocery store 365 days a year, you could always buy apples. Apples are always in season at the grocery store, but that's not when they're truly in season. Here in Las Vegas, apples just came in season, and yet it's the end of June as I'm filming this. We have fresh apples here in Vegas. I actually picked some up earlier this week. That being said, for most of the country, apples are like a fall time crop. when they're being harvested, but yet you go to the grocery store, you could buy apples year round. So what's really important for me is that you guys eat locally and seasonally. And so Keith, you want to share more about locally and seasonally and how important it is, and especially to some of your customers that you've met at the farmers market and how they appreciate your local food?
Seasonality is important because a lot of people don't really know about fresh food, ripe fruit. A lot of the food that you get now in stores, it's shipped thousands of miles away. It's usually not even harvested when it's ripe. And most people don't realize how good food can taste when it's fresh and it's in season. So that's kind of what made a big difference with me with gardening, is when I started learning what food can actually taste like. That's really what got me excited to grow more food. And so most people don't realize, but it's important.
Yeah, and then now you're able to basically, because you have a farm, you meet customers at the farmer's market. That's how you sell your produce, your crops, and you get to hear their testimonials and their results. Like, what have some of your customers told you about the food you're growing right here, Keith?
Yeah, so one of the crazy things, I've never been a big fan of eggplant. But when we started growing eggplant, I really started liking it. And when we took it to the farmer's market, we got a lot of the same responses from customers that some people said, it tastes like styrofoam, I don't like eggplant, but they would go ahead and buy ours because they wanted to see if it was any better. And they would come back the next week and they say how much they loved it. It was just delicious and they would buy more. And that really encouraged me to grow more, because it's just tasted completely different than what people were even familiar with.
Yeah, I mean, people are familiar that are watching right now, like a homegrown tomato versus like one of those tomatoes from Mexico that's pink, that bounces, like those taste like nothing. And a homegrown tomato tastes good. And that's how everything, like from eggplants grown from the store, like I buy eggplants from the store, they taste like cardboard, right, like yeah. Literally. But the eggplants that I grow myself, or that Keith grows here locally, right, in his backyard, like, they're just so sweet and good. Like, I can eat it plain without even adding any dressing or salt or pepper or anything, man. It's just good on its own. So, like, I'm really glad that you're able to, you know, reach people at the farmer's market and get them into the local food culture and how much better food could taste. I know you got some big major challenges growing here in Las Vegas. So what would you say, Keith, is your biggest challenge you've had growing here in the desert?
There's a lot of them. Pest pressure is definitely tough. We don't have very harsh winters, so it doesn't knock everything out in the cold season, so they come back a lot quicker, especially now the winters are getting shorter, and so the pest pressure comes in a lot earlier. That's definitely one issue. Our soil type is not like any other place in the country. It's very sandy. Elaine Ingram would call it dirt. It's not soil. It's not alive. It's definitely just dirt. So, which is good and bad. You kind of have a clean palate to start with, but it takes some time to really get it viable and get life going and make it grow healthy, delicious food. And so that's definitely a challenge. But there's a million of them, really. And that's two of the bigger ones.
Mm. And what has been your biggest joy of growing a garden and a farm here in Las Vegas?
Wow, there's a lot. I like putting smiles on people's faces. I like interacting with people. I like people getting excited about what we're doing. We're hyper local, so when we tell people that we live, you know, just a few miles from the market, that really stuns them. Like most of the stuff that we're bringing, we harvest the morning of. Some of it we harvest the night before, and that really blows people's minds that it was just, you know, on the plant or in the ground within the matter of hours. And now it's, you know, it's going to be on their plate. We're right around the corner from a lot of restaurants and chefs. You know, they like buying our stuff, and then we see pictures in magazines and on the website, and it's something to be proud of. You know, it's you worked hard at it, and it's the little things that most people don't think of, and until you start doing this, and then it's the little things that count.
And how many hours a day are you out here on your farm, like, working?
Depends on the time of year. This time of year, it's tough because it's so hot in the middle of the day. Usually, you try to get in a few hours, several hours in the morning time. And then you have to kind of quit from 12 to 4, 5-ish, and then you come out and you work till after dark. So, I mean, you could work anywhere from 8 to 12 hours pretty easy without, and I do it with a smile on my face. Like, I love it. Like, I mean, if I just wish I was 20 years younger again and had more energy, because, yeah, could pull off more hours if my body could handle it. But yeah, there's always something to do. We're a small farm, but people don't realize that, you know, how much work goes into it. There's always something to do, even on a small farm like this.
Yeah, even in my backyard, I'm always behind. I'll never catch up.
Yeah, see, you know.
So today you got a special behind-the-scenes tour of the farm here, because Keith gave me a personal tour, so thanks, Keith, for
course,
that. But
man.
Keith doesn't normally offer tours for people, but Keith, if somebody really wanted to come for a tour, would you do that, or I don't know, what are your thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, I love teaching people and talking with people about this. We can't have a whole lot of people, so, you know, if you wanted to come by, like, I could, for maybe a small fee, a little bit out of my day, I could show you around and, you know, show you what I'm doing, but just can't have a ton of people. But I would always love to teach people. That's definitely something in the future, especially kids, you know, like, I would love to do that for sure.
Yeah, so basically the farm's not an open farm where you could just stop by. You can't do that, but if you want to contact Keith privately, and maybe he'll give you a personal, you know, private class for a fee, maybe he'd be open to doing that. So, Keith, how would somebody contact you to do that?
You can contact me through Instagram. It's Hosena_farms. That's one way to do it, and it's probably the best way to do it.
All right, great. Yeah, I'll put a link down below to his Instagram. It's getting rather dark, and we're going to lose all our light, and maybe it's already pretty dark for you guys already. So a last few questions. So
sure.
If somebody wants to buy your produce, what farmers markets do you sell at here in the Las Vegas Valley?
Oh, thanks. Yeah. So our main market is the one on Southeastern in Henderson. That's on Sundays from 8 to 12. That's the one that we try to make it to every week. We're having enough now that we can kind of make it to the one at Bruce Trent Park on Wednesdays. It's Fresh 52. That's the owners that run it. And the one at Bruce Trent's on Wednesdays in the evening time, but I can't guarantee that we're going to be there every week because sometimes we just don't have enough to do both. But every Sunday and on Southeastern, it's right off the 215 on Eastern. That's where we're at from 8 to 12, Fresh 52.
Yeah, that's where I saw them at actually about a year ago or something.
Yeah.
During the pandemic, I saw them out there.
Yep.
It was fun. Nice. Cool, man. Any other words of wisdom you'd like to share with everybody today before we got to sign off today, Keith?
Well, if you're going to start small. I mean, I'm sure people have heard that a million times, but it's true. You don't want to overwhelm yourself because then you're just going to get discouraged, especially here. You're going to lose a lot more battles than you win, trust me. So, especially when you first start. But everybody should start. I mean, people are seeing with the supply chain issues, the pandemic, about your health. Growing food is becoming a trend, and I wish more people would do it, for sure. So get out there, get your hands in the dirt and grow something.
Wonderful. Yeah, I mean, and Keith, you know, he found my videos back in 2012, back in the day, and he didn't know how to garden. Look at him now. Look at this place, man. He's got like more plants growing than I got growing myself.
Yes, we
but I also got a lot smaller space too.
We owe you a big thanks, man. Like, we learned a lot from John back in the day, and you know, we didn't know a single thing about anything back then. And watching him, you can learn a lot. And so just don't be discouraged. Just do your homework and just keep trying, because eventually you'll succeed. It'll take time, but you'll succeed. And then you'll have more food than you know what to do with. So.
Yeah, I mean, and Keith and I were talking earlier about our failures, some of the failures we had, because we both had failures. And that's how you learn. So the most important thing I want to leave you guys with today is I want you guys to start if you haven't started yet. No matter where you live in the country, you could always be growing some food, even if it is some microgreens indoors because it's the winter time. Even in July, when they say you can't grow anything in Vegas in July, you shouldn't be planting new stuff. Keith got plenty of stuff he's still got to get into the ground. I got stuff I got to get in the ground. I'll plant through all summer. Now, you got to do a few things differently if you're planting in the middle of summer and it's super hot, but you could do it, right? And so I want you guys to start a garden no matter where you live, or even start some microgreens, start something growing, grow some sprouts inside your kitchen so you guys could get the gardening bug. And then maybe one day you too will have a farm, and maybe one day I'll be visiting you covering your farm and how you did it on my YouTube channel.
So if you guys want to learn more about Keith and his farm, link down below to his YouTube as well as his Instagram page, and you want to check him out on the Sunday Farmers Market, Fresh 52 in Henderson. That's probably one of my favorite markets in Vegas because they actually have a few real farmers there, because a lot of the farmers in farmers markets in Vegas are basically just resellers selling California produce, which to me is not really a farmers market. You could just go to your Sprouts farmers market and kind of get the same stuff, or maybe even better stuff, all right, for that matter. So if you guys enjoyed this episode with Keith visiting the farm here, be sure to give this video a thumbs up. Keith is a wealth of knowledge, and maybe I'll come back in the future if I get a lot of thumbs ups, and we'll share some more, drop some knowledge bombs with you based on what Keith has learned here growing in the Mojave Desert. Also, be sure to share this video with somebody else. Share it on different forums here in Las Vegas so that people could learn about where they could source some high quality fruits and vegetables grown here in the desert from Hacienda Farms. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new and upcoming episodes of Commandery 5 to 7 Days. You never know where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Make sure you click the bells to get notified as many videos come out. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge, over 1,600 episodes at this time on this channel, dedicated to teach you guys all about how to grow your own food, no matter where you live. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.